And I think a lot of what he does is for sound effects. And so sort of disregard the noise and don't follow the shiny object, but try to think about what the, you know, ultimately what the policies are gonna be.
Former Florida U.S. Senator Mel Martinez says you may want to forget about Trump the candidate and focus on the future. He thinks President Donald J. Trump may just surprise you.
It'll be repeal and replace. It will be essentially simultaneously. It will be various segments, you understand, but will most likely be on the same day or the same week, but probably the same day, could be the same hour. So we're going to do repeal and replace. Very complicated stuff.
From doctor's visits to emergency care, how soon could a repeal or overhaul of the Affordable Care Act affect your health and your wallet? And with President Trump now in office, Palm Beach takes on a familiar designation. We look at what the return of a winter White House will mean for Palm Beach County. That and more. Stay with us as we dive into your South Florida. Hello and welcome to Your South Florida, your source for the conversations that matter to our community. I'm Pam Giganti. I'm excited to make my return to TV right here on South Florida PBS. Thanks for joining us. This week, our nation sees an historic changing of the guard in Washington, D.C., as President Barack Obama transferred power to now President Donald J. Trump. What impact will the new president have on our nation and our future? And what will his policies mean for South Florida? Former U.S. Senator Mel Martinez sat down with us for a wide-ranging discussion about what South Floridians can expect from the Trump presidency. We begin with immigration, a topic the new president has vowed to take tough action on day one of his administration.
President Trump will now be confronting the reality, not what you say on the trail, but really what can be accomplished, and also what is good for the country to accomplish. So if we look at the wall, well, Mexico's going to pay for it. Well, now it's going to pay for it on a credit card, I guess, because it's not going to be now, but it'll be later. So that's already one acknowledgement that everything you say cannot necessarily become national policy. Obviously, more needs to be done to secure the border properly. I think that beyond the rhetoric, I think the reality is that some of it will not be necessarily a physical wall, but it'll be electronic. It'll be measures that are designed to protect our border, but yet not necessarily a big old wall with a beautiful door and all of that, you know. Right. So that'll be the border security component of it. And no question there's going to be an immigration bill. As I talked to my former colleagues in the Senate, I think there is an acknowledgement that we can get an immigration bill done. And I think, frankly, that'll be a very good thing. Now, there are issues like the Dreamers, what happens to them. Right. I can relate to the Dreamers because I myself was a young child that came here, and getting an education was my key to success and an opportunity to have a good life in the U.S. So to deny anyone an opportunity to become educated, that is a young person that's here and always going to be here, I think it's a big mistake. At some point, I think there'll be some acknowledgement that while President Obama did it the wrong way by fiat executive action, that there's a way that we can legislatively allow those children that now are not so young and allow them to continue to flourish in this country and have a good life. So I think there'll be a legislative fix for that. And while there won't be necessarily, but the executive order will probably go by the wayside, and then there'll be in a limbo status until legislation comes in. So I think that's another key why there should be an immigration bill to fix the problem for those Dreamers.
So getting back to the issue on border security, I think most people would agree they certainly don't want to allow criminals into the United States. But what do you think is a good policy to help keep us safe? Because frankly, especially here in South Florida, we're a gateway to the rest of the world, and so many people come through our airports and come into our community.
So I think Miami, frankly, is a lesson to America about what the positive aspects of immigration are. I mean, through our history, you know, immigration has been a very positive thing. It has been something that has been at the heart of who we are as Americans, a country of immigrants, a country where anyone can come from disparate parts of the world and make a success of their lives and contribute to the America we know today. The problem is that when it becomes illegal, when it becomes scary, when you have the threat of terrorism that we currently live under, I think people want to see a secure border. So I think what we have to understand is come to a point where we have relished our diversity. We continue to do that. We understand it here in South Florida. As I said, we can be a lesson to others. But I think we all have to acknowledge that uncontrolled migration, as the Mariel boat lift or other times that we've seen here in South Florida where local services get stressed and things like that, we have to have order in our immigration, and there has to be border security. So I believe that measures directed towards border security are something that have a widespread support among our people. But equally, I think not deporting hardworking people that are here to make a living, that have come a long time ago, that are now ingrained in our society, I think those are two principles that can live side by side.
And speaking again about security, because we just had that horrific mass shooting at the Fort Lauderdale Hollywood International Airport. People hadn't really thought too much, perhaps, about the baggage claim area of the airport. It also brings up fear, I think, of other soft targets, maybe arenas and stadiums, which we have here in South Florida, even the mall, for heaven's sake. Right. So what do we do about that to help us feel safer? Because that really jarred a lot of people.
Unfortunately, the intersection between mental health and guns is one that we've seen time and time again. So aside from terrorism, I mean, this Lauderdale event, it was just someone who unfortunately should have been taken care of by our medical system. I mean, he obviously was giving up red signals when he went to Alaska and the FBI intervened. So there are ways that we can prevent this. I think also we need to look at traveling with firearms. I'm one who believes in the Second Amendment and all of that, but traveling with firearms is not an inherent right. And perhaps if you're traveling and the only thing in your bag is a handgun and some bullets, perhaps that should be a red flag too, you know? So there should be ways in which we can discern the potential for people that are traveling that may or may not be a good idea that they be traveling with a firearm. So I think there are things we can do to improve the situation. I think it's really horrible and sad to think that people are collecting their bags and baggage claim and all of a sudden someone dies, you know, unexpectedly and needlessly. And I think, Pam, we've got to really address the issue of mental health. You know, the issue of, frankly, along with that, addiction. I know that the Congress recently appropriated funds for addiction treatment. Mm-hmm. You know, we've got to really address this epidemic in our country of addiction, opioid addictions that we're seeing, and concurrent with that, issues of mental health. I think all of that together is a facet of our health care that we've really relegated to a second-class citizenship, and we shouldn't, because we see the outcome sometimes when they flare up in a public way like the Lauderdale Airport. But we also see it in people's families and in the way that so much family violence and things like that happen that really are issues of mental health.
Yes, so I think calling it almost a health crisis.
It is. It really is. I think if, you know, the Zika thing got in the news, and my goodness, how many people died of Zika in South Florida? But the truth is that this is an epidemic of equal proportions, and that doesn't get quite the resonance of something like Zika.
No, you're absolutely right. Some people, and I know you've heard it from others who you've talked to, are downright fearful of a Trump administration. They're afraid of what's going to happen these next 4 years. There are others who are hopeful, and there are some who are downright happy about it. They see perhaps a good economic turnaround for us, and maybe that's why they elected Mr. Trump in the first place. What do you see for the future?
Well, I think on the economic front that the news has been really, really good so far. Even before he's taken office, in addition to the, you know, job gains that have already taken place, I think a little bit of economic nationalism, which I'm a free trader by nature and historical background, but I do think a little bit of nationalism as it comes to trade may not be altogether a bad thing. Okay. And it's frankly a trend going on around the world, looking out for America on the economic front a bit is not a bad thing. But here's the wisest way, I think, to analyze a Trump presidency. And I'll give credit to Haley Barbour, a very wise gentleman who was, like me, a former chairman of the Republican Party and former governor of Mississippi. And he said, you know, Mel, the media took Trump literally but not seriously. The voters took him seriously but not literally. And so I think a lesson to understanding Trump is don't take him literally. one of his new to be White House counselors said, it's not the words he uses, but what's in his heart. Well, I don't know that we can divine what's in his heart, but I think we need to be thinking of not what the literal tweet that he sent out.
I was going to say, because on Twitter,
I think life would be much better.
For good and for bad. We saw it when he talked about Carrier, and so then Ford made a change and kept jobs, so you would say that was great. That was a positive, effective tweet. But then some of the other things that he tweets, you just... You say, somebody please take the phone away.
I know. Life would be a lot better. And I think at some point he's going to recognize that when people around him are spending 9/10 of their time explaining, frankly, what sometimes is unexplainable about his Twitter, and trying to deflect the created controversy of the day over Twitter, and not advancing his policy goals, that he's going to realize that he's disadvantaging himself because they're spending all their time cleaning up after him. Uh-huh. So what I'm suggesting is that maybe on the weekends, rather than having the time off, that they give someone, okay, you're Twitter in charge this weekend. You got Twitter duty.
Right.
And make sure there's always an adult around.
Yeah.
Right, to have a Twitter sitter for him. Because, really and truly, the literal of what he says sometimes is just outrageous. And I think that, frankly, like I said, there's good people there. I think that governance is going to be better than what it has appeared, quite honestly. And I think people can get very hysterical. I know people on the right that were incredibly hysterical about the Obama election. And I remember saying to them, look, I served in the Senate with this guy. He's an American. He loves our country. Okay? And at the end of the day, he's going to do what he thinks is best. Now, do I agree with Obama policies? Particularly on foreign policy, I think he's been disastrous. But that's not to say he wasn't trying his best with a heart in the right place. I think we need to give President Trump the same benefit of the doubt. You may not agree with his policies. He may make you crazy on Twitter. But you know what? He's our president for the next 4 years. We got to hope for success. We got to hope for the best. And I would say that the hysterical reactions, just take a deep breath. Take a deep breath, because I think the people around him are going to be a sobering influence on him, and I think a lot of what he does is for sound effects, and so sort of disregard the noise and don't follow the shiny object, but try to think about what the ultimately what the policies are going to be.
Right, and hope for the best, like you said.
Right. And it's a great country. I mean, our democracy does allow us to refresh and renew.
Mm-hmm.
So 4 years, there's a lot of people I know that are saying, man, I've made it through 8 years of Obama. And so now they're having their moment. And, I think the biggest thing as a Republican, is that when you have total control of government, the White House, the House, and the Senate, be careful. Mm-hmm. Do not overreach. Be disciplined about what you do, because overreaching is the clearest way to help rebuild the Democrat Party. And I think that's one of the cautions that I think should be built into our Congress as we look forward to the future. And by the way, I also have tremendous trust in Mitch McConnell and Paul Ryan. I think they're good, solid people that I think are going to do a great job of leading the Congress. And I think there'll be a sounding board that'll be very strong for the White House. I also, by the way, think it's a very positive thing to have Chuck Schumer as leader of the minority Democrats in the Senate, as opposed to Harry Reid. I think Chuck Schumer is a negotiator. He is someone that can get things done. I think he's someone who's much more constructive than Harry Reid was.
Okay.
And so I look forward. Harry Reid may have been the Trump of the left, And so I think having Schumer in place is a good thing.
Okay. Thank you so much, Senator Martinez, for talking with us
today. My pleasure. Good to be with you, and best wishes on your show.
Thank you.